the Westminster Presbyterian Church, we are so glad that you have joined us today to worship the Lord our God. Before we begin our worship service, we have just a few announcements. Number one, there will be no children's church today and for the rest of the month. Parents, this one's for you, just for planning purposes, no children's church today and the rest of the month. Secondly, you'll notice on page 7 of the bulletin that our Discovering Westminster class will begin on August 28th, taught by Aaron Mesner and Carlton Wynne. This is our membership class, so if you would like to join the church, or just if you're interested in learning more about our church, this is a great class, highly recommended. It starts on, again, August 28th. We hope to see you there. I believe you can sign up by contacting the church office or Andy and B.A. Snyder. And that information is in the bulletin on page 7 as well. Thirdly, over the last couple of months, we have been collecting supplies for Crates for Ukraine. And just this past weekend, actually, our very own Kim Crawford has delivered 6 crates with 300 pounds of supplies for relief for Ukraine to Poland to then be delivered into Ukraine. If you are interested in this ministry, you can reach out to Kim Crawford when she returns tomorrow, or Chet Lilly as well. And then finally, we are just echoing the announcement from a couple of weeks ago. We are still on the lookout for nursery volunteers. So if you are interested, we would just highly appreciate you giving of your time to keep our children in the nursery as they are brought up in fear and admonition of the Lord. I'll say, as a parent, I'm especially appreciative of this ministry, so we hope that you will consider volunteering in our nursery. Now I ask that you would prepare your hearts for worship by considering the words from the book of Job. God is wise in heart and mighty in strength, who alone stretched out the heavens and trampled the waves of the sea, who does great things beyond searching out and marvelous things beyond number. Behold, he passes by me and I see him not. He moves on, but I do not perceive him.
Call to worship this morning is from Psalm 29. Ascribe to the Lord, O heavenly beings, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. The Lord sits enthroned over the flood. The Lord sits enthroned as King forever. Amen. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, you are worthy, O Lord, to receive blessing and honor and glory and power. For you are the King of glory and the King of all the earth. You are seated on your holy throne and you reign over the nations. Great and marvelous are your saving deeds through the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. O Lord, we desire none on earth besides you. Nothing can compare to you. When our flesh and our heart fail, you are the strength of our life. You are our portion forever. So be with us in our worship. In Jesus' name, amen. People of God, when there is a strong wind in our lives that rages against us, we must remind ourselves that Jesus has power to still the storm and help us. For Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Now let us all stand and sing hymn number 300, Blessing and Honor and Glory and Power.
Amen. Please be seated. A responsive reading this morning is from Psalm 107. It is printed page 1 of your bulletin. And as we confess the scriptures together, I will read the text in light and ask that you respond by reading the text in bold. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from trouble and gathered in from the lands, from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south. Some went down to the sea in ships, doing business on the great waters. They saw the deeds of the Lord, his wondrous works in the deep. For he commanded and raised the stormy wind, which he lifted up the waves of the sea. They mounted up to heaven. They went down to the depths. Their courage melted away in their evil plight. They reeled and staggered like drunken men and were at wit's end. Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. He made the storm be still, and the waves of the sea were hushed. Then they were glad that the waters were quiet, and he brought them to their desired haven. The Lord for his steadfast love, for his wondrous works to the children of man. Let them extol him in the congregation of the people and praise him in the assembly of the elders. Amen. Well, let us stand and sing once again hymn 88, "With Grateful Heart My Thanks I Bring."
Our Father in heaven, we thank you and praise you for your steadfast love endures forever. We thank you that the incarnate Son of God came to the earth as a man to pay the price for our sins by his sacrificial death and glorious resurrection. Thank you for the promise that you will be with us always. We thank you that you are our refuge and strength and ever-present help in trouble. And we thank you for the sanctifying work of the Spirit who produces in us the fruit of the Spirit and guides us to obey the word of God. We now give our tithe and offerings. We pray that you would use them for your kingdom and glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated.
Let us continue in our worship as we stand and sing the words of the doxology.
Amen. Please be seated. Would you bow your heads again with me as we confess our sins and intercede for the saints and for the world? Let us pray. Almighty and glorious Lord, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are the true and the living God who hears and answers prayer, and to you shall all flesh come. While many other voices clamor for our allegiance, we say in our hearts, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. And yet, our God, no sooner do we come to you, the God who is the standard of all righteousness and love and purity and justice, than we realize our lowly estate, we realize the depths of our sin. In the light of your face, we know that what masquerades as righteousness and as so pleasing to our own eyes grows filthy in your sight. The secrets of our hearts unravel before you. The schemes and the sins that we cherish lie before you, with nothing to hide them, with nothing to hide us. Lord, we cannot cover our sin any more than we can cover ourselves from your eyes and from the searching spotlight of your Spirit. But you, O Lord, are a God who does the covering. You are pleased to cover our sin and to remove our guilt through the blood of our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we come to you in his name, each of us individually and all together as your church. And we confess our sins and we plead the righteous obedience of Jesus for us. We confess, therefore, that we have broken your law. We have neglected your means of grace. We have doubted your word and cast it behind our back. We've quenched your Spirit. We have loved this world. We have hated our neighbor. We've not given ourselves to you in true devotion, nor have we believed all that you have said concerning your Son and our Savior. But Father, in the light of your presence, we come to you now, and we remember that as our sin increased, grace has increased all the more in his appearance. So as Christ is exalted to your right hand, we ask that you would look on him, that Lamb whose blood takes away the sin of the world, and that you would pour out upon our heads the cleansing mercy of your love. Would you renew us this morning? Would you establish us in union with him through faith? And in union with him, would you let us live again more and more through him this week? Father, your word says that if you have given us Christ, how will you not also along with him graciously give us all things? We are heirs of heaven. We are heirs of the world to come. We have life and peace with you today in him, but we also have many needs of which you are intimately aware. And so, Lord, we pray first for all in this world, but we pray especially for those whom we know and love, who must come to Christ and live. Let all of our friends and our families, our neighbors and strangers around us, let all the ends of the earth see the salvation of our God. To that end, Lord, we pray for the churches in our midst. We pray for the churches of the Metro Atlanta Presbytery, that they would preach and teach the word with integrity and spirit-wrought zeal. We pray especially for Tucker Presbyterian Church. And we pray that you would meet all of their needs out of your riches and glory in Christ. We pray especially that you would provide for them a place to meet and to worship after this December. We ask that you would bless their particularization service on August 28th. We pray that you would care for the Veermans and bless Eric Veerman as he leads that congregation. And Lord, would you bless this church as well? We pray for our members. We pray that we would grow in grace and in love, and that you would do your mighty work even through the trials that we face. We pray for Amy Langley again in this season of so much loss. We pray for Craig Briley after the passing of his mother last month, for Lee Knippenberg after the death of her father this past week. We pray for all of those who are battling against illness. We think of Linda Estel, Jimmy Leek, Lydia Gonzalez, Eldon Toll. Oh Lord, there are so many in our midst who are fighting to fix their eyes upon heaven and to bear up in this life. And so in all of our trials, whether extraordinary or mundane, we pray that you would reveal the power of Christ's life in our weakness. We pray that he would come to us. We pray that his Spirit would enable us to endure in him with all joy and perseverance. Finally, our Father, we pray for you to pour out your common grace to stabilize this world and bless our surrounding culture. We pray that you would heal our divisions and remove the abuse of the weakest among us. We pray that you would cast away the confusion that reigns over who we are as your image, and that you would enable our leaders to rule with wisdom and understanding. Oh Lord, would you change the speech of the peoples to a pure speech, that they might call upon the name of the Lord. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory through the reigning and the returning Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Well, friends, let's stand and sing together the Gloria Patri. Please remain standing for the reading of our sermon text this morning. Again, from John chapter 6. Just a few verses this morning, verses 16 through 21. And as I read these words, please remember that this is God's holy and inspired and inerrant word written for you and for me this morning. When evening came, his disciples went down to the sea, got into a boat, and started across the sea to Capernaum. It was now dark, and Jesus had not yet come to them. The sea became rough because a strong wind was blowing. When they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and coming near the boat, and they were frightened. But he said to them, "It is I. Do not be afraid." Then they were glad to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat was at the land to which they were going. Amen. Please be seated. And let us pray together. Our Father, those of us who have received and rested in Christ for our salvation know that in the Christian life we can be raised up to the heights of joy and faith and peace in him. And yet in the very next moment, cast down in the darkness of doubt and fear. Lord, we pray that by the very presence of Christ among us through his Spirit, he would calm our fears, soothe our hearts, and lift us up to delight in true communion with Him who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. We pray this in His name. Amen. If you've been with us in past weeks, you know that we've been walking through the miracles, the signs that John the Apostle records in these early chapters of his gospel, signs that Jesus performed during his earthly ministry. He calls them signs because, again, they point beyond themselves. They point to Jesus, to his identity, to the reason for his coming. In fact, it's good to revisit occasionally the purpose statement that John himself gives for writing the Gospel of John. Remember, he says in John chapter 20, verses 30 and 31, "Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." That is the purpose of John's gospel. That is the purpose of the signs that Jesus performs. This is the purpose of Jesus' ministry, that you and I might believe that Jesus is the Christ. He is the long-awaited Messiah, even the Son of God. And that by believing in him as crucified and raised and returning, you and I might have life, true life, eternal life, unbreakable life with God now and forever. Well, how does all of this begin? Well, we could say that the Christian life begins with seeing Jesus for who he really is. Lately in the Wynne home, there has been talk of one of our sons starting driver's ed. Aside from being a shock to my own system, this has caused me to reflect on my own experience in driver's ed at age 15. And I remember, even to this day, one of the fundamental principles of the Smith system of defensive driving is make sure they see you. Make sure they see you. That is to say, you need to not only be aware of your surroundings, but you need to make sure that other drivers see you on the road. And so you need to stay out of their blind spot. You need to make eye contact with other drivers. And above all, you need to use your signals early and often. Jesus has been making sure that his disciples see him properly. And he's been using his signs, his signals to do it. Remember back in John chapter 2, we read that when Jesus turned water into wine, that first of his signs, the text says that he manifested his glory. And then last week, we looked at the feeding of the 5,000 in John chapter 6. And in verse 14, we read this: "When the people saw the sign that he had done, they said, 'This is indeed the prophet who has come into the world.'" And even when Jesus doesn't perform a sign, the people around him can't help but see him and even call other people to do the same. Recall back in chapter 1 when Nathanael heard Philip say, "We have found the Messiah. It is Jesus of Nazareth." Nathanael doubted and he said, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" And do you remember what Philip said back to him? He said, "Come and see. Come and see." And then in chapter 4, when Jesus engaged with the woman of Samaria by the well, and she goes off to her townspeople, what does she say? "Come and see a man who told me all that I ever did." Well, in our text this morning, in this fifth sign recorded in John's gospel, we read in verse 19 that the disciples indeed see Jesus. They see him in a stunning and an unexpected way. And it's Jesus who indeed comes near to them. So the question for us this morning as readers of John's gospel is this: what are we to see about Jesus? What are we to see as we see him as he really is? To know him, to believe in him, that we might have life in his name. Well, to answer these questions, the first thing we need to do is to see how this text fits into John chapter 6. Because at least at first glance, this is a rather strange account. In fact, that's the first point of our sermon this morning, a strange account. John 6, 16 to 21 is strange in at least two ways. First, It's strange because it's situated right in the middle of two sections that deal with the feeding of the 5,000. We looked at that event last week, again in verses 1 through 15, when Jesus multiplied the bread and the fish, fed over 5,000 because there were women and children there in addition to the men. And we're going to see, beginning next week, that starting in verses 22, really to the end of this long chapter, Jesus engages with the crowds and the Jewish leaders and his disciples about the meaning of the feeding. And right in the middle of it all is this event of Jesus' walking on the Sea of Galilee. Without any explanation, without any elaboration. In fact, if we were to compare John's gospel account with the account recorded in Matthew and in Mark, we see that John's account is rather condensed. But these verses are also strange because of the way John describes the scene, especially in verses 16 and 17. For example, why did the disciples leave Jesus by going down to the sea and departing? Why does Jesus come to them later? Why does he come to them in the way that he did? Above all, what is the meaning exactly of this particular sign? Why did Jesus choose to walk on the water? Did he just run through the manual of miracles and think this would be a wonderful way to amaze his disciples? Well, maybe we can clear our eyes a little bit by looking to the parallel accounts in Matthew 14 and in Mark chapter 6. Now, remember last week we focused in on John's gospel and we saw unique details that John included that the other gospel writers did not. Well, this week I think it's actually helpful to look at the other gospel accounts to glean what they say. And when we turn to Mark chapter 6, verse 45, we learn that the disciples go down the hillside to the northeastern shore of the Sea of Galilee and they depart from Jesus because Jesus has told them to. Mark 6:45, it says this: immediately he, Jesus, made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. Now remember, this is the same crowd that in John 6:15 we learned wanted to take Jesus by force and make him their national king. They saw the power that he had. They said, this is the king for us. And yet, this is not why Christ has come. And apparently, Jesus wants to remove his disciples from this scene while he disperses this crowd. And remember, ascends up the hillside to pray. And this is what Mark tells us that Jesus did next. And we can surmise that Jesus told his disciples not to wait for him, but that he would meet up with them at some later point. It's possible that Jesus might have implied that he was going to walk the long way around the northern shore and meet up with them later. Well, aside from simply recording the miraculous way that Jesus did in fact come to them, why does John include this right in the middle of chapter 6, all of which deals with the feeding of the 5,000? Well, again, the crowd wanted him to make him their earthly king. But Jesus is intent on showing himself on his own terms, and particularly with his disciples. He wants to show them that he is not an earthly king, but is in fact the King of Kings. He is the King of all creation, the ruler over all that he has made. And because of this, he's not only the King of creation, he is the King of the new creation. He is the King, as we will see, of redemption. This will be important for the rest of the chapter because later in verses 52 and again in verse 60, the crowd on the other side of the lake is going to doubt his explanation of the feeding of the 5,000. When he says all of it is pointing to him, this is a bit of a spoiler alert, that he is the bread that has come from heaven to give his flesh as life for the world. And the people will doubt this saying, and many will turn away from him. But his disciples who have experienced this event on the boat will know that Jesus can do it. In fact, when all turn away, Jesus will turn to his disciples and he will say, do you want to turn away as well? And this is when Peter utters some of my favorite words in all of Scripture. He says, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. And we have believed and have come to know that you are the Holy One of God. How has God worked this confession so deep into Peter's heart? How might God work this confession so deeply into our own hearts? Well, for this, we need to turn second to the stunning encounter. The stunning encounter. The text picks up in the evening. This is a word that could refer any time late afternoon to just before sunset. It probably was just before sunset because verse 17 says that it was dark when the disciples started out. All they had was the high moon at the time of Passover lighting their way. And initially, the disciples had intended to travel a rather short distance. You see, the Sea of Galilee lies in that northern region of Israel known as Galilee. It's sometimes called the Sea of Tiberias. We learned that in John 6 earlier. The sea is about 7 miles wide, 13 miles long. By the way, it's the lowest freshwater lake on earth, about 700 feet below sea level. The Old Testament calls the sea of Chinnereth or Kinnereth, from the Hebrew word for harp, because that's roughly the shape that the sea makes. It's kind of an upside-down pear shape with a bulge out on the west side. And if you think of that northern shore like the top side of a clock, the disciples were intending to travel from about 1 o'clock to about 11 o'clock in terms of the distance, just a short cut across the northern shore. But this short journey would take them deep, even hours and hours into the night, almost until dawn, because of the arrival of a sudden windstorm. It's well known that cool air from the west and the land that rises high on the eastern side of the lake, an area known today as the Golan Heights, causes sudden and violent storms on the sea. One 19th century writer puts it this way: "Small as the lake is and placid as a molten mirror, I have repeatedly seen it quiver and leap and boil like a cauldron when driven by fierce winds from the eastern mountains, and the waves run high enough to fill or cover the ships." Well, this is exactly what happens, even to these men, many of whom were fishermen and familiar with the sea. The wind blows, and it pushes this 15-passenger fishing boat way off course. Verse 19 says they were some 3 or 4 miles of rowing out to sea. Mark 6, 46 says the boat was out to sea with no sign of help. Mark implies that this occurred all the way up for about 6 or 7 hours, the four men rowing the boat furiously, fighting the winds. I want you to imagine what this would have been like. And if you can't imagine it physically, maybe you can imagine it spiritually and emotionally. How were they feeling? No doubt they were saying, "How did we get here? What are we going to do?" Above all, they were asking, "Where is Jesus?" Surely we can relate to this. We can relate to the fact that life brings unexpected and devastating trials. One of the privileges of being a minister is you get to do weddings for people. You have the front row seat when the groom and the bride are taking their vows. And I often think to myself, what young couple can possibly imagine what the words "in sickness and in sorrow" might actually mean for them? What couple can possibly anticipate what joys and, yes, what tears might be spurred in time by the newborn in the delivery room? How many of us have ever woken up and said, "In all my years, I never dreamed that I would have to deal with this"? How many of us have asked, why would God do this with me? Where is Jesus now? Well, I want you to remember where Jesus was on this occasion. Where was he? When the disciples were rowing against the wind hour after hour, where was he? He was up on the mountain. Mark says he was praying and he was watching. He could see them from where he was. His eye was upon him. They were not outside of his sovereign purpose. A.W. Pink puts it this way. He says, "Even though it was dark, Jesus saw them. No darkness could hide those disciples from him. And this too speaks to us," he says. "We may be toiling and rowing weary of the buffeting from the unfriendly winds and waves, but there is one above who is not unconcerned, who sees and knows our painful lot, and who even now is preparing to come to our side. Now, my question in my own heart is, why does Jesus prepare? Why does he wait? I love the strange verse in Isaiah 30, verse 18. You've heard it before. Therefore, the Lord waits to be gracious to you, and therefore he exalts himself to show mercy to you. For the Lord is a God of justice. Blessed are those who wait for him. One of the singular purposes of God for our life is that we would learn to wait. Why does God do this? We don't often understand the details, do we? But one thing we do understand is that God has his sanctifying purposes through our waiting. God has done this generation after generation after generation. Abraham waited 25 years for the child of the promise to be born. Israel, his chosen nation, waited 1,000 years and more for the coming of the Christ. Even today, the Apostle Paul describes the church as a waiting people. Listen to what he says in 1 Thessalonians 1. He speaks of Christians who turn to God from idols to serve the living and true God and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come. In all of our waiting, let us also remember that God does not leave us without evidence of his power and faithfulness. This is true of the disciples in the boat, wasn't it? They should have known that Christ would come to their aid, that he was sufficient to provide. And how might they have known? Well, I hope this isn't too much of speculation, but let us remember those 12 baskets full of broken bread fragments that they took up after Jesus multiplied the food. What do you think they did with those basketfuls of bread? Did they go down to the sea and just sort of chunk them to the birds? I don't think so. In all likelihood, they brought them into the boat with them. And so while they were furiously rowing against the waves, the evidence of Christ's own provision and power would have been right under their noses. But Jesus gives them more evidence, doesn't he? He gives them a signal so bright and so clear that they couldn't miss it. Verse 19 says, when they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and coming near the boat, and they were frightened. Let's just focus in on the miracle itself. Jesus reorganizes the principles and laws of mass and gravity, and he actually steps on the water. He's not walking along the shore. He's not a few yards in. They are in the middle of the sea, and he comes to them. The winds do not ruffle him. The waves do not threaten him. He comes near the boat. And Mark says, initially, they were terrified, because originally they thought it was a ghost. They thought it was some apparition. And then the familiar words come. It is I. Do not be afraid. Well, back to the big question. What does this sign point to about Jesus? Why this particular sign in this time of need? Let me just mention 3 things to you. First, this sign, of course, reveals Jesus to be God himself. It reveals Jesus to be God himself. Now, Mark, again, includes a strange detail that drives this home. In Mark 6:48, it says, he came to them walking on the sea, and he meant to pass by them. What a weird detail. He meant to pass by them in their hour of need? Yes. These words are pregnant with Old Testament significance. Do you remember when Moses was up on Mount Sinai and he cried out to the Lord, show me your glory? And God says to him in Exodus 33, I will make all my goodness pass before you, and I will proclaim before you my name, the Lord. And you remember that Moses would have been obliterated had God revealed the full weight of his glory to him in a moment. And so what does God say? He says, while my glory passes by, I will put you in the cleft of the rock. I will cover you with my hand until I have passed by. What a wonder that Jesus is revealing his glory to his disciples as the very Son of God, the one who is merciful and gracious, who is slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. He's revealing his glory to them. And yet we do know, don't we, from the text, that to see God in his glory is indeed a fearful thing. We see it in the Old Testament with Isaiah when he sees the Lord and the train of his robe fills the temple. And he knows that he's not worthy to be in the presence of God, that he would be unraveled and undone in the presence of God. When the angel of God comes to Mary and to Joseph, what are the first words? Do not be afraid. When the disciples see Jesus risen from the dead, he must say, it is I, do not be afraid. To see even a glimpse of God is a fearful thing. And yet how marvelous that Jesus sees their fear and he doesn't pass by them, but he comes near. And he joins them. Well, why on water? What significance does this have? Let's look at the second thing. This reveals God in all of his glory as the ruler of creation, doesn't it? And might I turn your attention back to the preparation for worship verses printed in the bulletin from Job. These verses are actually from Job chapter 9. That's a typo on the preacher. But Job says, God is wise in heart and mighty in strength, verse 8, who alone stretched out the heavens and trampled the waves of the sea. Now, in the Greek translation of that verse, the word for trample is the same word that John uses for Jesus walking effortlessly on the water. Have we reckoned with this about our Lord, that even when he came in the flesh, even when he drew near to us in our humanity, in his person, the person that he is, the person who took on the divine nature, Jesus was and is God himself. He is the Son of God. He is the one through whom the Father made the watery world and then formed and filled it and crowned it with the creation of his image. He is the one who still rules all of creation with perfect power. So even when he took on a changing, finite, feeling human nature, in taking that nature to himself, let us always remember that Jesus was and is God. The same I, the same person who took on flesh and lived and died and rose has existed unchangeably from all eternity. Herman Bovink says this, Christ was God and is God and will forever remain God. And even when he became what he was not, he remained what he was. Did you catch that? Even when he became what he was not, even when he took on human flesh, he remained what he was. For he who according to the flesh is from the fathers is according to his essence God over all. Blessed forever. And all of this is deployed for the good of his people. Because Jesus is and remains the divine Son of God, he is ruling over every circumstance that we face. Because he is and remains the divine Son of God, he hears all of our prayers and is able to answer them. And because he is and remains the Son of God, he has the power to triumph over the worst that you and I face. And this leads us to the third significance of this particular sign. Not only is he God who is the creator, but this sign anticipates Christ's own triumph over the storm of death and the darkness of sin. The sea, familiar though it was to his disciples, is also in Scripture a symbol of chaos and darkness and death. It is a symbol of that which swallows up life. And again in the Old Testament, God triumphs over the waters. Most significantly, of course, in cutting that way through the Red Sea, Psalm 77, 19, as he leads his people out of the clutches of death, and then as he overwhelms, remember, the armies of Pharaoh in those same waters. Much earlier, God reversed his creation and sent a flood that covered the earth, but through those waters rescued Noah and his family. And in all of these events, God is not only saving the family through whom Christ would come, but in these very events, he's demonstrating for us what that Christ would come to do. In a climactic way, he would save us from the judgment of death. And the Old Testament anticipates this again and again. Isaiah 43:16, thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea, a path in the mighty waters. Behold, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? Or Habakkuk 3:13-15, you went out for the salvation of your people, for the salvation of your anointed. You crushed the head of the house of the wicked. You trampled the sea with your horses, the surging of mighty waters. Friends, for God to trample the waters ultimately means for him to show himself to be God in the salvation of his people. It is to show himself to be the ruler of every dark thing that the world can throw at us, even the darkness of death itself. For God to make a way on the sea is for him to defeat the specter of death forever. And this is what Christ has come to do. And he's come to do it ultimately by enduring the darkness of death that we deserve. And yet, as he has taken on flesh, as he really and truly experiences the death that God in his divine nature could not experience, his divine glory shines through. Because in his flesh, he tramples on the waters of death by rising again on the third day. And having ascended to his Father's right hand, he has gone up to the Mount Zion above. And what is he doing there? He is interceding and he is praying for his beloved church. Hebrews says, he is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. Scottish preacher Robert Murray McShane says that if I could hear Christ praying for me in the next room, I would not fear a million enemies. Yet distance makes no difference. He is praying for me. Sometimes we say to one another, I'll pray for you. I say that a lot to members of this congregation. And I know that when I say that, I must immediately pray because I might forget. But friends, Jesus never forgets. This is integral to his heavenly ministry on behalf of his church. And what's he praying for? He's praying for your growth in grace. He's praying for your dependence upon him. He's praying for your endurance as you wait for him. He's praying for your faith. And brothers and sisters, hear this. When Jesus prays, all of his prayers are answered. And they're answered in the way that he prays for. Because your Father in heaven, whose being is one with the divine Son, delights to hear his Son's prayers. They are perfectly in accord with his desires. Well, we've seen the strange account and the stunning encounter. Let's look briefly at the satisfying conclusion. The satisfying conclusion, because this is what's coming for those for whom Christ prays. Verse 21 says, then they were glad to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat was at the land to which they were going. Literally, it says they were wanting to take him into the boat, and that's just what they did. And then it says, immediately they arrived at their destination. How did this happen? Kent Hughes asked, did they just sort of hydroplane into the shore? Well, he says this. The times we spend with the love of our life fly by. And I think the disciples were so caught up in worshiping him that time ceased for them. And suddenly they found themselves on the shore. How wonderful to be so preoccupied with our wonderful Savior. I think he's onto something. Because when we live in fellowship with Christ, when we're confident in his provision, when we are safe under the lordship and ruling of his powerful divine person, not only do his prayers enable us to persevere through every storm, but as we wait for him, we will know that he will bless us with an eternity of joy that all eternity will not exhaust. Friends, do you see Jesus for who he really is? Is he coming into focus for you as we march through the Gospel of John? And whatever storm you may be in, have you received him gladly? Are you heading with him to your eternal home when all will be well? And when you will know that whatever you face today is for your ultimate good in him, is he even now with you by his Spirit? If so, know that he will be with you now and forever, until the day when we see a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth will have passed away. And what does John tell us? And the sea will be no more. Let's pray together. Father, we long and wait and expect the full revelation of the glory of our Savior, and even now we plead for the presence of the Holy Spirit, that we might endure whatever storms you are pleased to permit in our lives, and that in the midst of them we might see Jesus high and lifted up. For we pray it in his name. Amen. Friends, let's stand and sing together our closing hymn. With gratitude in our hearts, it is well with my soul.
Oh,
Oh, may the Lord direct your hearts to the love of God and to the steadfastness of Christ. Amen.